We talk about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse, Snacky Tunes.
Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. It is Monday. What is the date today? November 2nd. You are listening to Snacky Tunes. I am one half of your host, Finger on the Pulse, DJ Never Forget. Sliding into his seat is Terry Diabolic.
Hello.
Hello.
Can I say this right now?
Yes.
Thanks, Roberto's. I'm trying to get three delicious pizzas.
Yeah, we just, the reason why that song ran a little bit longer. And what was that song, actually?
That was the Revoir Simone Airplane remix.
And why did you play an Revoir Simone song?
Because they are going to be in the studio later this afternoon. What?
They will be performing live and just talking about upcoming projects and food. And
I feel like our paths have crossed a lot with them. Or almost crossed.
Almost crossed. They're one of those, like, we should have met a long time ago type bands.
But we're going to meet in just a little bit.
We have a packed show today. We also have Rob Smart, who was our first food guest way back in August, to be talking about his article, 10 Things You Should Teach Your Kids About Food, or Kids Should Know About Food.
I have a feeling I'll probably know about 2.
Yeah. Well, this I already know 10 because I read the article.
Okay, but up first, we have Derek and Andrew from... Are you guys from the Bell House? Can we say that?
No, we're from the Brooklyn Beefsteak.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me start over. Okay. We have Derek and Andrew from the Brooklyn Beefsteak, whose event, the Brooklyn Beefsteak, will be happening at the Bell House this Sunday, November 8th. Welcome to the show, boys.
Yeah, welcome to Snacky Tunes.
Good to be here.
Yeah, thank you.
So, gentlemen, for those who don't know about the illustrious, wonderful tradition of the Beefsteak, why don't you fill our listeners in?
Well, I guess the Beefsteak goes back about 200 years to Old New York, the docks on the west side, and we're essentially trying to bring it back to Brooklyn. It survives in New Jersey in a different form, and essentially it's a cow fell off a truck, they would take it in saloons, cut it up, and serve it to a boisterous crowd of raucous men. And it kind of changed over the years, moved to Tammany Hall, took it up and made it into political fundraisers to buy votes. And, you know, we're trying to bring it back to Brooklyn. We think it's rightful home. It's where it deserves to be.
Now, when you say a cow fell off a truck, is this like, the TV fell off a truck? Yeah. Or like the
cows don't just fall off trucks.
I think they were grabbed off the truck.
Illegally.
So this is your first one, right?
Yes.
Where did you guys get the inspiration to bring something like this? I mean, I know you want to bring it back, but where... We don't sit around and be like, we want to do a food event. Like, let's do an all-you-can-eat meat and beer festival. Well,
that's exactly what we did.
There you go.
What many people don't know is that no silverware, right?
No silverware.
And every piece of meat is served on like a little piece of bread, right?
Yeah. Stale bread.
Now, talk to me about the tradition of bread stacking.
Okay. Well, the bread stacking came that I wouldn't say that's part of the old school from the turn of the century. It's a New Jersey move to kind of showcase their gluttony to their friends at the other table and to make it in kind of a competition. So each piece of bread symbolizes a couple, you know, represents a couple ounces of beef. So the taller the stack gets, the bigger balls you have.
I imagine in the old days people were probably eating the bread, but nowadays you sort of stack it up to compare how much you've eaten, you know, to your neighbor.
Awesome.
I would say, though, that they're not eating nearly as much as they did back in the day. The record is 8 pounds. He lost to someone who would eat 7.5 pounds. So
that's a lot.
And they were, you know.
Yeah.
That's disgusting.
That's disgusting. You know, I was looking at they've got these great, like, fun fat cars at 8 pounds, and I was like, that doesn't seem like that much. And then when you said, I was like, wait a second, 8 pounds, like, a 16-ounce steak, I'm like, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm just like, oh, I can't do it. So. Now, you're using one of our favorite beef purveyors, Pat LaFrieda. How did you get involved with them, and what's their role in this?
Pat was actually introduced to us by a friend of mine, Fran Derby, who is the chef de cuisine at Momofuku Sambar.
Dude, we know Fran.
Yeah, I know.
Fran. We know Fran from back in the day.
Dinner with the Band.
Dinner with the Band, yeah.
I actually was on set with you guys at one point.
What?
Yeah.
Now you're mentioning this. Back like on air, so yeah. like you guys were too
well,
busy.
I figured it was perfect for on
back air. In the old studio.
I was with Sam Mason and Fran one day when Sam Mason did his show, and he was baking some sort of olive cobbler.
Oh, the Matt and Kim episode.
Yeah,
oh,
okay. Matt and Kim, right.
Anyway,
right.
Enough about us.
Yeah.
But November 24th on IFC, Dinner with the Band premieres. Back to the Brooklyn. Yeah. But so anyway, so Pat LaFrieda, so Fran hooked you up.
Right, and he suggested that Pat was a good guy to deal with, and Pat deals with Creekstone Farms, and we just took it from there.
That's amazing. And so will you guys be preparing the beef on site? Is it offset? How is this? I'm kind of curious.
That's hundreds.
I mean, seriously, this is a lot. I mean, and you really can't.
And at the Bell House?
And you really can't. You can't control how much. You're going to make an assumption.
Yeah,
how
we're
many
making
pounds
assumptions.
How many pounds are you bringing?
We're bringing about 350 pounds.
Oh, my God.
And how many people?
How many people?
A little over a pound per person.
A little over a pound. Well, it's going to be 250 to 300 people.
Yeah. I mean, that's a lot because, and the beer, McSorley's, I mean, they'll be washing down the beer. I mean, a pound of, because people are
going
to eat bread.
I'm sorry, I'm going for the record.
I'm sure there'll be others that are going for the record.
Yeah, I'm sure. So is there anything else that you guys would like to add about?
Where do I get tickets?
Yeah.
Where do I get tickets? Yeah, how many are left?
So there's probably, as of right now, 50 or 60 tickets left. So we're pushing.
Just want to let you know, when they wrote me over the weekend, there was 100. So you do the math.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, another couple of days, we'll be sold out. You get them at the Bell House website or brooklynbeefsteak.com.
That's the bellhousenewyork.com.
Yeah.
Bellhouseny.
And you guys have been gracious enough to let us give away 2 tickets on air.
Yes, definitely.
So write us music@fotpnyc.com with beefsteak in the subject line with a guess of how many pounds you can eat.
You know what? Let's give it to a devoted listener. What is the world record of how much beef was eaten in a beefsteak?
Oh, okay.
If you can't get that, then you don't deserve it. Especially if you're a podcast, all you got to do is scroll back.
What time does this start?
Starts at 3, 3 to 6.
Oh, so it's Comaville for the rest, maybe crawl home, watch some football, things like that.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You know, we kind of like, Thanksgiving starts around 4, beefsteak starts around 4. So
gotcha.
Get on it.
All right, guys. Well, thank you for joining us. This is going to be a great success. It sounds like you're going to have some great press out there. I'm sure you will sell out You said you were in the New Yorker, right?
New Yorker, New Brooklyn Yorker Paper.
Today. Awesome. Yeah. So we highly recommend getting your tickets today. Oh, and live music from Susquehanna Industrial and Tool and Die Company.
Yeah, Hillbilly.
Hillbilly.
Boogie Town.
Because that's really actually, I want to hear some fiddles when I'm slamming down beers and eating meat. So we got Terry Diabolic about to drop another tune. We've got, I'd like to give a shout out to our sponsors, which I am pulling up right now, which is Franny's Brooklyn, which is a great other restaurant, really committed to sustainable agriculture and wind power and using new types of energy, and they make great pizza, and I'm told their cheese is fantastic. Coming up next after the break, we have Rob Smart to talk about 10 things every kid should know about food, and then I'm staring at probably one of the cutest bands I've ever seen in Brooklyn, Avoir Sumrun Through the Window, who are going to be playing live around 2:30. So stay tuned to Snacky Tunes. You were listening to Snacky Tunes. That was just Freelance Whales, one of my favorite things I saw at CMJ. I've still have to get their record, but
I have it.
Oh, you have it. Well, we should exchange it. But I've been listening to their MySpace religiously.
And that was just a Generator Carrot First Floor.
I think it's actually just that's the wrong thing because it's a different symbol on their MySpace, so it could just be.
I guess my iTunes.
Yeah, just didn't recognize it. That was a great interview.
It was. Really nice guys. Fresh out of Wesleyan.
Slamming on a calzone.
Slamming on a calzone. I remember those first free meals out of college. Anyway, if you're looking for two innovators who like calzones, hit us up. We'll get you the emails.
So one of my favorite interviews that we had from the show was actually our second show was with Rob Smart, who is the creator of Pro Foods. And I've been looking for a reason to bring him back on. I just don't want to bring him back on just to be like, hey, you're awesome. And we had actually were having dinner with Patrick, who runs the Heritage Food Network, and he had told me about this woman who had been going around and trying to literally trying to save the public food, the public school food system.
Right.
Currently, just the way it works, we're spending 72 cents per kid per day for ingredients, which is absolutely nothing. And it's kind of gone from a fresh ingredient to a reheat, repackaged plastic type of thing. And then
now this is sort of in the same vein of what Alice Waters did out in Berkeley and what Jamie Oliver did out in London, of just starting young. Because that's where eating habits are formed.
That's where they're for. And the woman's name is Ann Cooper, and she wrote a book, Lunch Lessons, Changing the Way We Feed Our Children. So I read it, and I thought it was good, and then it just so happened that recently Rob came out with an article, 10 Things We Should Teach Every Kid About Food.
Boom.
Boom. So it seemed like it would be a great time to bring him back on. And Rob, are you there with us?
I'm here.
Rob, welcome back to Snacky Tunes.
Welcome back, Rob.
Great to be back, guys.
We have grown our listenership considerably. And we, first off, want to say thank you for being on with us so early on in our trials.
It was my pleasure.
So you recently wrote this article, 10 Things We Should Teach Every Kid About Food, which I know that you wrote partially for yourself and also because you have some children. But do you want to talk a little bit about, the inspiration behind it, and then also, this idea behind your sustainable economics track for school systems?
Yeah, sure. Well, the interesting thing is that if, you get out in the space and you talk to a lot of people about sustainable food, most of the people you're talking to are adults, at least the ones that I've been talking to, and you either find people who are very receptive to it and already doing a lot of things around becoming more sustainable and how they deal with food, or you come across people who are sort of entrenched in their interests. So that got me thinking, well, there's got to be a group of people that we can be focused on that are going to help drive some of this forward and from an economics point of view, and that's, people who are going to be spending money. So I started thinking about kids, and then, of course, there's if you guys have been following Twitter at all, Happy Chickens. There's a 12-year-old kid in Mass that is doing some really great stuff around raising chickens as well as bees. And he's just an incredible voice out there, and I actually had him write a post on my blog, and he further inspired me. And I think after that, I just felt like it was really important to, boil things down, and what can we be doing with the young people to get them to really wrap their heads around, what's going on with the food system and how it fits into their lives. And then, out of that came this idea of sustainable economics as a replacement of home economics, because I don't know about you guys, but home economics doesn't really ring true anymore to what people are thinking about. So,
right, I hear you. I have not seen that Twitter, but that sounds amazing. I mean, there's 10 points here, so I'm trying to think about which one to particularly focus on. The one that I thought that was interesting, besides your basic, learning the basics about it, was food advertising.
Yes,
that to me seems like something that, I feel that we've grown up as kind of a cynical generation, but still, kids are susceptible to it. So, what would that type of education look like, and how would you be teaching kids to, what to look for?
Well, if you think about what, food companies, the big ones at least, what they have to do every year is they have to come up with new products. And, the new products have high margins, and it drives their bottom lines, and it allows them to satisfy the insatiable demand of their shareholders, which, is just how the system works. But what they end up doing is they target a significant amount of those food products towards kids, especially young kids. And they spend, tens of billions of dollars a year in advertising to that audience. And so what I think is really critical is for kids to understand what's coming at them. I mean, it cannot not have an effect at such scales. And if you look at just recently, if you're following Smart Choices, this industry food program where they tried to create a front of box label that said this is a good healthy food, and they were putting it on things like Fruit Loops. It was amazing, and the FDA stepped in and knocked them back a notch. And they've since then, that program started, has kind of lost its wind, and hopefully it will just go away. But the problem is that they're hitting kids with all these messages. They're putting information out that is, honestly, from what the FDA said, misleading and untruthful from time to time. So I think it's really important for kids to understand, about what's in advertising and how companies are advertising to them and why they're advertising to them, so that they can become a little more aware. It's not necessarily going to change, their behavior, but at least it gives them a little more balanced to think about what's coming at them.
What do you think is going to take for those type of corporations, and even I get to switch from looking at kids as consumers and customers to our future?
Well, unfortunately, I don't think in corporate America they can do that very easily. I mean, it's just the way the system's designed. You know, in a public company especially, every quarter you're getting measured on performance, and it's incredible pressure on these companies. And so, you know, there has to be, in my mind, one of two things. Either there needs to be an education process that consumers basically find better ways to spend their food dollars, which is a lot of what I'm working on with Pro Food and the entrepreneurial things I'm doing, or they need to have the government step in and actually start putting some boundaries around these guys. But, you know, that's a very difficult proposition. So, you know, I wish I had the $64,000 answer to that question, but unfortunately it's going to take a lot of hard work and I think a generation or two, and then we'll hopefully be, you know, in a much better place.
This is, you know, one more question from us. You know, you are obviously a parent and have great, you know, knowledge about this and can teach your kids, but if I was a new parent and I wanted to start educating myself and my children about this, before, you know, the school system came around, you know, where could I start? Where's a good place for us to start besides you or Ann Cooper's book?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. You know, with our kids, and we have four, and the oldest is 13, the youngest is four, and, you know, we've just always made it a point to have fresh food in our house and, you know, participate in the shopping experience, have a garden, you know, go to farmers markets, join a CSA, things that can get the kids to actually get connected to the actual food and then be able to come home and see that food being transformed into something to eat. If they're involved in it and they, you know, and the kids are actually in the kitchen, even if they're not chopping or doing stuff, but they're watching this process and they sit down and they realize how good that food is, I think that's the simplest thing that people can do. And I think it's been very effective. Our kids eat almost everything, and I mean that literally. It's very few things that they won't eat, and they don't complain. So we're fortunate, but we've also put a lot of time and energy into that. So
awesome. Well, Rob, thank you so much for joining us. Just want to let everybody know, everytable.wordpress.com, where you can read all of his wonderful articles and learn more about him. And also, if you're on the Twitter, it's twitter.com/jambutter. Rob, thank you so much for joining us. We will definitely have you on again in the near future.
Great, guys. Appreciate it. Take care.
Thank you. Have a good afternoon.
All right. Bye-bye.
Great. I love that guy.
Great guy.
He always has good stuff to say. And he was so easy to get a hold of and to join us.
Forgot one question. We'll follow with Rob. But, you know, eating well, things like that, definitely topical coming off a weekend like Halloween. I mean, you know, yeah. At what point, it can't be all good. At what point can you sneak in a little bit of the bad? I guess if you balance everything, then a little bit of the bad.
So we are staring at Revoir Simone, who are eating some Roberta's margarita pizza. But before we get to that, we just wanted to follow up. We had our first dinner at the Rising Tide on Thursday.
Thank you to everyone who came out. Big shout out to Dave Colston and Garrett Oliver. Hello, Kathy Irway.
It was fantastic. We just wanted to give a quick shout out and thank you to them. We will be getting photos and everything and posted up probably on our website, hopefully within the next week or so. So we've got a DJ set coming up from Terry Diabolic. We're going to bring Revoir Simone into the studio. They'll be talking about recent tours, upcoming projects, playing live, and I think a couple songs off of their iPod. You are listening to Snacky Tunes. We are your host, Finger on the Pulse. Once again, thank you to Franny's Brooklyn for sponsoring the show. To Jack Tech, for Rec Tech and Jack Ensley, mix that up a bit, for keeping us up and running, and to Roberto's for feeding us during this. Terry, take it away. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.
right, everybody. Terry Dybok fading it down. You're listening to Snacky Tunes. I am one half your host, DJ. And forget you are listening to Heritage Radio Network live from Roberta's in the back.
From Roberta's, delicious pizza, good time.
So who was that you just played?
That was, start with Kami Hot, which you passed my way, which I love. Then Don't Cry, the Miguel Campbell edit by Matt Hughes. And then It's Only Love, the Figure and Sleepy Tea track, which has essentially just been on sort of loop for like the last, I don't know, month.
Right.
It's fantastic.
It's good stuff.
It's good stuff.
Speaking of good stuff, we have...
Nice.
Yeah, right?
Nice transition.
We have Avoir Simone in the studio today. Welcome, girls.
Hi. Hello.
Thanks for having us.
Oh, our pleasure. I keep trying to use the effects pad, but I always like hit like the angry boo or like a cougar.
No, do it. Try it.
Do a cougar. Okay.
Yeah, do it.
See. Danger.
Just see, yeah.
That's a good one.
It's pretty good. All right, we'll take Sire.
You should just get some finger symbols like me.
Oh, perfect. Can we hire you?
Oh, yes. I'm available a lot, actually.
Available for finger symbol sound effects.
Yes, you just have to pay me with pizza.
Done.
Can do.
Yeah, calzones, pizzas.
And this crazy coffee that they have here.
Stumptown. Gets in your veins.
It's too much for me.
It's my favorite. I used to go to Portland specifically to drink Stumptown, and now they brought it to Brooklyn.
So you never have to go to Portland again.
Yeah, and I gave up drinking coffee.
Oh. So why don't you introduce yourselves?
My name's Erica.
My name is Annie Hart.
And I'm Heather D'Angelo.
And I know that you farmed in about...
I'm like Madonna.
You're the diva of the group. So you formed in 2003-ish.
That's what they say.
That's what they say.
I don't remember, so I just have to read the bio to remember.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that's what I'm reading. That's what your manager sent me.
If Wikipedia says it, it must be true.
Yeah. These are what I like to call talking points to kind of bring up. Why don't you know what? Forget the talking
forget
points.
It. Throw, hey, girl,
why don't you tell, if you could tell the fans, like, one fact they should know about Avoir Simone, they should know this.
We play no guitar.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's a good fact. That's a really good fact. Yeah. Avoir Simone, they don't play guitar. So if you see keyboards on stage with no guitar, and Brooklyn, chances are. So we've been trying to get you
all
on the show for all chicks.
All chicks all the time.
All chicks all the time and no guitars. These are great facts.
These are great facts.
Why is
Wikipedia updated right now?
This should just be
somebody
right.
Please update.
Anybody's
it.
On Wikipedia, please edit our page. Yeah. We're too it's proud really to do boring. It ourselves.
Yeah. I keep wondering, you know.
We need some more scandalous details on there.
Should there be scandalous details?
Well, it's just sort of boring right now, I think.
We're kind of boring people in the scandalous department.
Oh, okay.
I mean, if you get me drunk enough, I might dance on top of a table, but only with all my clothes on and like after everybody already left the club.
That should also be in Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Let's live update that.
That's on right now. So we've been trying to get you on the show, but you've been on the road and you were just telling me where you've been.
The last place we were... It was Mexico City, which was so amazing. If people want a getaway, like, it's a really amazing place to go. It's super, like, the architecture is amazing. The food is amazing. It's super, like, fancy, kind of. And really, the colors, beautiful things to look at. Really it's sweet beautiful. People.
You listen to the media or your friends talk, and you think this swine flu ridden kidnapping
drug war, kind of
crazy place. But I stayed there for like 3 extra days after we played, and everything. It's just this beautiful city. It's way more. It's built on a sort of European style of wide avenues and beautiful architecture, and people look out for you. It's just very friendly. The food is amazing. Speaking of food,
it's a food show. Well, my two favorite foods are coconut and avocado.
Oh,
and like the first meal we had there, we got these like coconut agua fresca, or not even coconut like smoothie things, coconut milk, and then
it was the most delicious,
like
beverage
amazing
I've ever had.
Cactus tacos with avocado. Like like the avocado is just like endless. There's never
endless
enough.
Avocado.
Yeah.
Their eyes just closed.
And I've never liked mole before. And like Heather loves mole, and I'd never had good mole before. And she ordered this like mole duck thing, and I just
combining
had some of the sauce.
Combining my two favorite foods. My favorite food is duck, and the other thing is mole. So duck mole.
Did they tell you how many ingredients were in the mole?
Mm-mm.
No, a lot of different kinds.
Isn't
of
that
chocolate.
Irrelevant, really?
No.
It tastes good. You're kidding me.
That's the only reason why I asked, because most we went to this place in Bell in California, and they have a 42 ingredient mole, and like mole is just like. It takes forever.
Isn't that where you go in L.A.?
No. Yeah, but there's a... What's the name of the place?
Casita Mexicana.
Oh, I don't know if that's the name of it.
Oh, man. It's awesome.
You mean there's another Mexican food place in California?
No, but there's two really, really good mole places I've been to in L.A., but I don't remember the name of either of them.
Well, here's a third, because it's delicious.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, also, the drinks we had, we were schooled in the technique of having a shot of, like, one of those tall tequila glasses of really nice tequila and another shot glass of tomato juice.
Yeah,
and
it's
you sort
called
of sit back and forth.
Not
it's
sangria,
so
but
delish.
Sangrita, and it's tomato juice with, I think, hot sauce and lime in it.
No, and then the other one, or the lemon. Tequila has a lot of lime in it. So
the tequila
and the lime are combined in one cup, and then the fresh.
I think it was just tomato juice. I think it was just fresh tomato juice. It didn't have hot sauce. It was just
well, this sounds
so
like
good.
You had quite a few of them, too.
Yeah. No, we didn't.
Somebody ordered it for Heather, and then while we were DJing, and then some fans drank hers.
Yes, they did.
And then I had one.
Ungrateful.
And she was like, that's mine. And I was like, well, I'm already drunk. Take it.
And then also
I didn't even dance on the table.
The Mexican beer, and not with just putting a lime on the top is like one thing, but they would give you
Michelada.
A cup full, like with like maybe a third full of fresh lime juice. So then it was like way.
And then they salt the rim. And I was just really at good. Taco Chula 2 nights ago, mm-hmm. and they actually serve a lot of the same stuff.
I went
like
there
Cafe de Olla, which is literally translated as cauldron coffee. And it's they make it in a cauldron with cinnamon and then this. I can't remember the name of the sugar, but it's this super unrefined sugar, and like then they cook it with cinnamon and some other spices,
like
depending where you go.
And
it's more like this sort of like it's not reminiscent of chai, even though it sort of sounds like I'm describing that. But it's more like a very watery, sweet coffee with like some nosy.
It's still
spices.
Rich though.
It's
not like
still
super
rich.
Watery.
You always order that.
I always
yeah.
over we're at Impolvo's in Austin. Mm-hmm. Do you know that place?
Wait, where is it?
Polvo's on South First, I think. Anyway, I've had Cafe Dairy
there. I was
there.
Supposed to go there and it was closed.
Blew my mind. I know
it's,
exactly what you're
saying.
They
also
have the Everclear
margaritas
there. They
don't put milk in it, and I always have like milk in my coffee, but with that you don't need it.
You don't,
yeah.
you can, they just give it to you. It's like it's a totally different drink.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not yeah, it's less coffee. It's its own thing.
This seems like a good time for you to play a song.
Okay.
What do you, hey, by the way, not your best transition.
No, I know.
Philosophy of like of mole or food in general. This song's called All or Nothing, right? Oh. It's like
yeah.
Kind of like,
all right.
That's great.
Wait, we're gonna take a picture. Somebody's taking a picture of us. I don't know what to do. I'm feeling awkward. All right. So
there's like wires dangling in the pizza pies.
Is this a good tempo?
Is this how you guys
too
roll
fast?
Every day?
This is how we roll every day.
Wow. It's amazing you guys aren't fat.
Everywhere is somewhere, baby, so can't you see we're in the middle of somewhere? Nowhere just means knowing nothing of where you've been. You're a sight to see this early morning, getting lost in my own neighborhood. The same freedom you feel is what's been blowing in my cell since I arrived here. It's all, it's all, it's all or nothing. Thank you.
are slowly, slowly coming into view. The images are slowly
finding out for once. I know there's less to life, what's more is looking
for me. The images are slowly
saying yes instead of no, not wondering what might come my direction.
The images are slowly,
won't be long, best just to gaze and daze and fall to dream something familiar.
It's all, it's all, it's all, or nothing. It's
all,
it's all, it's
all,
or nothing.
That was just Au Revoir, Simone playing All or Nothing live on Snacky Tunes.
On one tiny little
Casio. I know, yeah, I was going to say, it's one tiny Casio, four hands, a finger cymbal, and an avocado
shaker.
We
should have segued into this by saying, speaking of delicious avocados.
Oh, yeah. Yes. You had a good transition, though.
Oh, live radio.
Oh, live radio. So that's off the new record.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was May.
It was May.
You say it's new.
It still feels new to
It was
us.
Late May.
Okay. Oh, so even newer.
Well, it's only early November, so.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's still, this summer went by really fast.
It did. I felt like, well, it wasn't really a summer.
Yeah, it rained a lot in Brooklyn.
We weren't here.
We weren't here. Where were you?
We were in Europe. We were across the USA.
Japan.
Yeah. Where weren't we? Not in Africa or Australia.
Well,
yeah.
No, I did one of those Facebook maps that it shows where you've been, and we really haven't been. We've really concentrated our travels on very specific, like,
it's true.
You know, Western Europe,
primary
USA,
and secondary markets.
Japan.
Yeah. Oh, I'm aware. I actually went to school.
That sounds a lot less romantic than Paris in spring.
Yeah.
Well, secondary market.
I went to a school.
Paris is a primary market for us.
Oh, it is? Oh, well, that's
the French name?
Definitely.
I think so.
Paris.
We pretty much, sometimes we go to Europe and just tour France for a couple weeks.
That's awesome.
I don't know what it is.
Awesome.
They love their not French. Girls.
The faux French.
The faux French.
They love faux French.
They love those.
They love Baywatch.
Love them.
Jerry Lewis. Yes.
Jerry Lewis and us.
So Trey Class.
And we love
as Aaron
them
would
too.
Say.
But you release this yourself, right?
Yo.
In the US.
In the US.
We have a label in Japan called Rally and a label in Europe, Moshi Moshi.
Which we spoke about, Steven.
Moshi Moshi.
Who is fantastic. He's a wonderful man.
Who doesn't love Steven?
How did you meet him? That's my
you know,
I had Michael
South
too. Let's
by
not forget
Southwest
Michael.
West
forget
plays Michael. A big part of it because we had a bunch of British labels who were like, we want your band, and Annie and I were down at South by Southwest, and Hot Chip was just getting big then, and so he was like, okay, well, I'm going to be at this show. Come and meet me. So we decided. Annie sat next.
No, I
on
sat
the plane.
Next to Magic Numbers on the plane before, like right before they blew up, and they were, or maybe they hadn't. I'm just so out of the loop, I didn't know. But I talked to them. I was like, "Oh, you're from England. Let me ask you about these various labels." And they were like, "If you have the opportunity to be on Moshi Moshi, you must be on Moshi Moshi."
I wonder if we
it was
that
just
same
like a fateful
show.
Thing. And yeah, it was
LCD Sound System.
Dude,
headline.
I was there.
Yeah, and that was the night where
I was totally there.
We called
front
Heather,
row.
And we were like,
looking at me so crazy.
We were like, we want to be on Moshi. And then we all went up and met Steve, and we were like, hey, nice to meet you. We want to be on your label. It was
and
just
he
really
was friends
magical.
With Matthew Perpetua.
Yeah, he found, he actually, and before.
Wait, is that,
Fluxblog.
Fluxblog,
yeah.
Who I also have met a long time ago.
He's
who
one of my best
turned
friends.
Me into, turned me onto Lo-Fi Funk, who I tour managed.
Oh.
Oh. Oh. Look at this, yeah.
Cha-ching.
Cha-ching. There it is. See, that's the sound effect.
Shout out to Matthew.
Shout out to Matthew. I don't think he even knows, like, he put that one track on there, and I was like, kind of changed
Changed the game for us.
What song was it?
Change Channel. One of those
oh,
two.
Oh, Change Channel. That's
whichever
one.
I'm sure
song.
He knows the post. It was like when I was still in college, actually.
How old are you?
27.
Oh, wow.
Can I say that on air?
You can say that.
Yeah.
We're not telling our
age. That's fine.
I might be, even though we're twins, I might be a different age.
Yeah.
So, I was going to ask you how old you were, but then I thought maybe the people on the radio wouldn't think that was funny.
I
like
think
the
it's
people
funny.
Listening.
Mom and dad, they'd
it
find it funny.
It wouldn't get it.
And anyone else would know.
But I wanted to know, I mean, you have labels, but then, you know, releasing it here. I'm always curious about bands that do self-releases here. Do you find, like, now in this day and age, do you have your own distribution?
Yes.
I mean, how does it, do the three of you run it? Or do you have...
Yes,
you
know, and yes.
It's like outsourcing to, you know, we just do what a label does, which is what Steven taught us, because he, you know, he's a small operation with Michael, and they just have... their publicist, and they have this and this and this, and so we just did the same thing. We have the ingredients that we need.
Yeah, we didn't realize that in this day and age, being a label is more like a coordination machine rather than you know, any special talent. Like, not that they don't have talent, but I mean that you know, like that you're not being the publicist and the distributor and this. You're hiring these people.
You
so,
can right. have it in house, or you don't have to.
Yeah, and it just seemed for us that we've always had good luck by working with people who were willing to help us and who wanted to. People who really believed in us. We in turn then believed in them that they were going to do a good job, and that's really worked out for us. And sometimes it's a logistical nightmare, you know. Sometimes you run out of vinyl when you need it for a tour and various things like that, or like you have to buy t-shirts at the last second. But you know, the more I talk to people who run labels, they have the same exact
problems.
Yeah,
it's like any business. It's like you do the best that you can.
Wait, so who does? I just want to know who does your distribution. Who does your PR? Just a minute.
So
shout out.
PR
they love
is
you.
Jenna Pellet, Press Here Publicity.
Love
Jen.
What's up, Jen?
Jen's awesome.
Jen's the best.
Not only is she hot, but she's very capable.
She and I have a phone call tomorrow.
Really? About what?
Dinner at the band. Thanks.
Ooh.
Yeah, love She's you, Jenna Powell. And who does your distribution?
The Orchard.
Oh. Who we have a meeting with soon.
Fantastic. Oh, so
we
you
should bring them some pizza.
Yeah, you can take whatever's left because I'm not.
I'm going.
I might have another
slice.
I might have.
I have to go to work.
If it's not burned, I got a burned one.
No, it's. I mean, it's rustic. It's not burned. It's rustic.
It doesn't look burned at all.
Yeah. But you can have as much. So here's another question. So when you're doing your France and Japanese tours, who's taking care of the business stateside?
Or is it? Our manager.
Oh, okay. But I was
shout wondering. Out.
Who I met on Thursday.
Rod Sherwood.
He was recording. We live in the same building as Headgear.
Oh!
We have the front place now.
We mixed our last record.
Actually, this is what we were talking about. Met. Like, how... We were talking about, like, there's... It's surprising that we haven't met before. Because we know all the same people.
I know.
And we're Brooklyn. So, well, I guess...
Now it's a whole new world.
Now it's going to be one of those things. I'll be walking in. Don't
you guys dare pretend not to know us when we say hi to you on the street.
No,
I'm going to pretend not to know them.
Oh. Yeah, well...
Until I say hi.
Oh. Then I'll be like, is she not going to say hi? Oh, she said hi. Okay.
Psych out.
Andy is not the type to play it too cool.
We sort of blew over it, but the new album...
Yes.
Talk about it really quickly.
It's called Still Night, Still Light.
I think my favorite track is Only You Can Make You Happy.
Thanks. Oh, I love that song.
It's like my favorite.
I gotta say,
we
though,
love that
we
song.
Had this thing, this vision in mind, and it didn't come out to the vision that was in my mind.
You should come see us live because it's better live.
But the cymbals still don't get big as big as I
because
want.
Because I love it, and
let
when
it
I
go,
hear it, just because
let it go.
I can hear it as like...
It's a perfectly
it's
good
a perfect song. It's great. It's
thank
really cute.
You. Thank you very much.
Like a,
thank you.
I know you do a lot of remixes with like Aeroplane and things like that, and that's how we open the show, but like that track, Strip It Down, make it a big house anthem.
Would you do that for us?
Yeah.
If I had the skills.
You have a vision.
Can someone do that for us?
We can figure it out. We'll find
somebody. We don't pay anything, but find someone.
That's fine.
We'll find
if you get us the stems, we can work on it.
We got stems.
Sweet.
Well, maybe we can even do a contest. We've never done like a remix contest.
Oh,
all right. Music
that
at FOTPNYC.
Awesome. Where's the call
only
in
you
right
can make
now?
You
what's
happy?
The caller number four?
We're putting out a remix album, so it's not like that there wouldn't be a platform for that.
Oh, maybe if it's good enough.
If it's good enough, it'll come on the remix album.
That's
but
so
really done really
so the album's doing well?
Yes.
Yeah, it's been a really fun journey.
Yeah.
And how have you, I mean, and let's talk about your relationship with Aeroplane, because you have done...
I just saw them at CMJ.
Amazing, right?
They, yeah, so we didn't meet them when they worked on that Friendly Fires thing. We just recorded. We just recorded. I'm passing the pizza.
For those who didn't see, that was a pizza attempt grab slam on the keyboard.
That's the sound of Okay, someone's hungry.
Because that friendly fryers
it's rad.
Is
yeah,
amazing.
It's amazing.
And you're like,
and so they just did that, like, you know, because our vocals were in the original track. But then they just worked on another song for us, and we sang on a song for their album, which is going to come out next year. And yeah, they're super talented. I think those guys
they're awesome.
They're not afraid. You know what I mean?
No,
they're not afraid to just do something kind of wild.
And that was the thing about the friendly fryers remix, is just that. Okay, I don't know Friendly Fires, and so they can beat me up later.
They're so nice.
And they're really nice, but I really like your version better. Because... Okay, I was trying to avoid saying that, but I was just saying it was just a reinterpretation of the song, and I thought, it's like, I wonder if the Friendly Fires heard this version, and went, huh. Like, that's what our song turned into, or they were, like, proud that
but
they were, like, the
They're more a rock band, like, and they're, like, a rock band, and Airplane's, like, a dance floor, so it's just a different animal, you know?
And in fairness, there have been remixes that have been done of our songs where I've thought the same thing. I'm like, wow, I kind of wish we had done
this. It doesn't
this.
Make you feel bad. It makes you feel like it's just another
you're the
evolution.
I mean, you're the seed of that
course.
Of that growth.
Exactly. You still wrote the melody.
Yeah. It was still your
it's just an
evolution. Your idea.
And even though you can't hear it, that track, well, I mean, is on the record. It's on the Friendly Fires record.
Yeah, which is weird. It's I was like, did they record new vocals? And then I went back and I was like, oh, I guess it's already on there. But like, it was buried is the wrong
but
way
also,
to say it. But
Airplane
it's just,
slowed it down a little bit and just made it like a little sexier.
It's a lot sexier. I mean, I don't. When
it's
I was
definitely
in the
sexy.
Yeah, when I was in the Friendly Fires thing, I'm not like, this is sexy. That your version sexy, Airplane the other one. Whatever.
So why don't we do you want to do one more song?
All
do you
right.
want to finish that? Do you want to
let Annie swallow first?
So we'll do one more song and then we'll come back and we'll sign out. Big shout out to Franny's, Brooklyn Lauder, great pizza, great cheese, Alvar Simone, Snacky Tunes.
That sucks.
As we figure out the song,
which song is this?
Oh, Anywhere You Look.
Okay, Anywhere You Look, Snacky Tunes, Alvar Simone.
Am I gonna play?
Take this off.
This is way too slow. It's like extremely too slow.
We do. That's too bad.
You guys are playing faster than the beat, I think. Yeah, there you go. Weird.
I'm just not playing my left hand because there's no space for me.
Okay.
Oh, dear.
All right. Well, we'll try again. Will it just come with the singing after one?
Yeah.
Okay. 5, 6, 7, 8. What would you say was the matter when we all laughed at each other? Thank you.
talking to me. Wavelengths pull magnetically, and I was right. And we knew when we tried harder, there would be another offer, knowing as we're falling under what was right. Anyone you loved once, 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 anyone you loved was right. Anyone you loved once, 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 anyone you loved was right.
Woo! Not enough clapping in here to say how awesome that
was. Was that all right?
That was great.
Because we sort of did a tempo change in the middle of the song.
I will say the two things that I was thinking while this, totally honest. One, this is one of my favorite shows we've ever done.
Wow.
And two, we should have more live bands in here. We have a lot of DJs because we have a lot of DJ friends, but and it's always great, but there's always something about bands when they agree to do live performances.
It's swinging back.
It's a balance. But this balance. You girls are great.
So,
and we actually, I had some people writing me saying that you sound great on there.
Really?
Yeah. Let's do some self-promotion. Website?
Well, we'd prefer if you go to our MySpace.
That's still a website. It's our website.
MySpace.com.
We're having some website issues. Anyone that would like to help us with our website issues?
No, I hired my friend already.
Okay. Oh, we hired a friend.
Next that.
Never mind.
Please sign up. But our website is good for one really important thing, which is you could sign up for our email list. And we're going to be playing a show in New York in January.
I think we should.
Not till January?
Yep.
Yeah.
We're going to China and Brazil next month.
We've been on tour for a few weeks. We need a break.
Okay. I think we should really pronounce the name of our band, because maybe people can't.
Oh, it's Au Revoir, Simone.
Au revoir, Simone.
Or however you want to say it. But it's AU REVOIR Simone.
You can spell yourself.
My iPhone learned the spelling of it. It like can learn.
Well, they don't call it a smartphone for nothing.
Yeah.
So where in January?
Highline.
Really that January long? 7th. You're not getting like any secret performances?
No, we just played CMJ and we added a bunch of instruments to our normally completely electronic lineup, which was really fun. But yeah, so
are you headlining Highline or is
yes? And I think you can buy.
We don't know yet.
Oh,
but we just confirmed this. So January 7th at the Highline,
we'll buy tickets.
And we would appreciate it if you came, because then we could continue playing shows in New York City, which is very easy for us to travel to.
Where can people get the record?
You can buy it at any store. And we actually have it out on double white vinyl, 10-inch white vinyl.
Yeah, it's nice.
You're interested in that sort of thing. So I think you can still get that at the record store. But yeah, you can buy the CD anywhere. It's a beautiful digipack our friend made.
Okay.
It's insane.
All right. Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having
really
us.
We really appreciate it. This was really one of my favorite shows. Thank Roberta's for the pizza.
Thank you, Roberta's.
And thank you to Franny's Brooklyn, who is our sponsor. And I was just actually looking at their website where
what do they do?
They are also a pizza place, but here's the thing. Here's the thing. It's a different location. It's a different location. They're a great sponsor. And they also have all the commitments that we love: sustainability, wind energy, new type of energy.
Say their name again. Franny's.
We want to go there.
They
said their mission statement is: Franny's is a team of over 20 hardworking and loyal people who are committed to giving our guests the highest quality and most consistent food experience possible. I kind of like that.
That's nice.
And they are. Where are they?
And don't forget,
they're on Flatbush Avenue.
Don't forget Brooklyn Larder.
Oh, Flatbush and what?
It just says 295 Flatbush.
We're gonna go there.
Is that near you?
No.
Oh.
My mom grew up right near Flatbush Avenue, but I think maybe that's the wrong end.
And then thank you to Jack Tech, Jack Inslee and Rec Tech. I just can't get that right.
Try it again.
Jack Inslee and Rec Tech. I almost messed it up.
You did it, but you got it right.
Jack Inslee and Rec Tech.
Don't sell yourself short. It was wonderful.
We are your hosts, Finger on the Pulse. You've been listening to Snacky Tunes. Next week, we have Lemonade in the studio, which is another great Brooklyn band.
I'm thirsty.
Oh, boom.
Bad joke. I really
We got one more song from Terry Diabolik, and we'll be back next week. Thanks for tuning in.
Bye bye.
Give him some life support.
C'est le temps.
de l'amour, le temps des copains et de l'aventure. Quand le temps va et vient, on ne pense à rien malgré ses blessures. Car le temps de l'amour, c'est long et c'est court, ça dure toujours, on s'en souvient. On se dit qu'à 20 ans, on est les rois du monde et qu'éternellement, il y aura dans nos yeux tout le ciel bleu. C'est le temps de l'amour, le temps des copains et de l'aventure. Quand le temps va et vient, on ne pense à rien malgré ses blessures. Car le temps de l'amour, ça vous met au cœur beaucoup de chaleur et de bonheur. Un beau jour, c'est l'amour.